In the yoga world, we have this common yoga alignment rule that for Chaturanga, it's very important. We tend to be taught that when we go into Chaturanga, we should shift forward onto the toes and then lower down, because it's in shifting forward that we are able to find that 90 degree angle at the elbow. And if we don't shift forward, and if we don't tell students to do that, and if instead students just lower straight down, do you see how that ends up bringing my elbows into more of an acute angle? So shifting forward does help us find more of the 90 degree angle. And if we were just to go straight down and not shift forward, we won't find that 90 degree angle, and it's gonna be more of an acute elbow angle. So in the yoga world, we tend to obsess over this angle at the elbow, and we think that it's all about that. Our injury risk is. But what really is taking place when we're thinking load, which is the variable that actually matters for injury in this conversation, what we want to understand is that when we start in plank pose and we shift our weight forward like this, when we come forward, we do change like the angles of the joints involved, but we also change the loading profile of the movement. When we shift forward, we send more weight into the upper body and less weight in the lower body. More of our collective weight is in the arms and shoulders here than if we don't shift forward. And in fact, if we were to reach back through our heels and actually shift back a little bit, we would send more load, more weight into the lower body, and we'd offload the upper body a little bit. So we'd even be loading the upper body less if we shifted back, which is like the opposite instruction we always hear in yoga, which is to shift forward. So if shifting forward loads the upper body more, and if shifting back loads the upper body less, what that means is that when we shift forward in Chaturanga, that is a progression in terms of the work that's happening in the pose. Shifting forward adds more load, more force to the upper body, so that the muscles of the upper body, the shoulders, the elbow muscles, they have to work harder to resist our weight when we shift forward than they do if we were to shift back or to just not shift forward and to lower straight down. So shifting forward is a progression, and shifting back is a regression. And when it comes to something like injury risk, it's really regressions and progressions that matter. It's really like reducing the loads involved that will keep someone like technically more safe. When we increase the load, we are, you know, increasing the forces involved. And if the tissues involved in that movement if they don't have the capacity to bear those higher loads, that's when we create a situation in which injury is more likely. So if anything, not shifting forward is actually safer for the upper body, the shoulders, the elbows, the wrists. Not shifting forward is technically safer than shifting forward. But we're taught that shifting forward is safer because of 90 degrees at the elbow. But that's just like really not the case. That's not how the body and injury works. So I think that is important for us to understand, just in terms of where the weight goes, where the load goes in the pose, and which parts of the body are being loaded more or less. That's what matters for injury. But let's get a little bit more specific about it, because I think this might be a little extra eye-opening for our yoga community. When we shift forward, we do load the upper body more, but we can get a little more specific about it. And let's think like the two main joints that are involved in this, in the movement that we're doing in Chaturanga, are the elbow joint and the shoulder joint. So the muscles of the shoulder and the muscles of the elbow are doing the most work in Chaturanga of the whole body. Chaturanga is, you know, we do have the core working in Chaturanga as well, but primarily the main load, the main force applied is to the upper body. Chaturanga, in like strength training terms, is a horizontal pushing strength movement. So we're working our shoulders in a pushing manner, in a horizontal push. So that's like the main load that's involved there. So we've got elbow, we've got shoulder. So when we shift forward and then lower down, what we actually are doing there is we are creating a longer moment arm for the shoulder. So that means that the muscles of the shoulder and the tissues on the anterior, the front side of the shoulder, they will be loaded more when we shift forward, like specifically more. So I know I said shifting forward loads the entire upper body more, just kind of in a general way. But if we want to get a little more specific about it, because of the moment arm for the shoulders in this forward position, and what I mean by that is that distance between the shoulder and the hands here. Do you see how the shoulders are so far forward? There's this long line out in front of the hands. That means that the shoulders are bearing more load in that forward position, and specifically the anterior shoulder. This area would bear less load if we did not shift forward, and if we just went straight down. Because then if we were to go straight down, there would be longer moment arms applied at the elbow, and then a shorter moment arm at the shoulder. So that means that the shoulder and the elbow, they can share the load more when we don't shift forward. But if we do shift forward, we add a lot more load to the front of the shoulder. And I think that that's important, like I said, for our yoga community, because you may or may not be familiar with this, but in the yoga world, there's a very common experience of something called casually yoga shoulder, which is just this like common pain, discomfort, achiness that a lot of yoga practitioners tend to get in the front of the shoulder, in the anterior shoulder. And I'm no fear monger at all. And I'm not here to suggest that shifting forward is like injuring the shoulder at all. But I do think that if we add all this extra load to the whole upper body, but also especially to the anterior shoulder by shifting forward, I think that that has the potential, we could maybe call that overloading the anterior shoulder, and that may have the potential to sensitize this area and maybe cause some pain there. So I just think that's interesting, because in the yoga world, we tend to have this yoga shoulder complaint as a common complaint. And in the yoga world, we tend to have this yoga alignment rule that in Chaturanga, we should always shift forward and then lower down because of 90 degrees, and because that's supposedly so important and so safe. I would just like to suggest that from a biomechanical perspective, it really, things might be completely flipped, and that if anything, not shifting forward is actually safe, and this whole 90 degree angle thing just doesn't matter. What, it's not alignment that matters and joint angles. It's not that, it's load and how much load we are actually applying to the different parts of our body. So this is all point one for why I think that this 90 degree rule in Chaturanga is not important. Let's turn our attention now to point two. Point number two for why this 90 degree rule in Chaturanga is not important. So what we're taught in the yoga world is that 90 degrees is safe, and that any lower than 90 degrees is injurious. So any lower than 90 degrees at the elbow would mean that the elbow is at an acute angle. So something like this. So that is supposedly injurious. That's what we're taught. We're supposed to avoid that and only hit 90 degrees and go no lower. So at the elbow in Chaturanga, what's happening there biomechanically is that the triceps muscles are being loaded. So the triceps muscles, the muscle with three heads, lives on the back of the upper arm, and it crosses the elbow joint. And the triceps perform elbow extension. They straighten the elbows. So in the strength training world, we have exercises designed to load the triceps and strengthen the triceps. So I want us to look at a couple of them, because I think that this might be a little eye-opening. So the first triceps exercise that we have in the strength training world is something called a triceps pushdown. And this is usually performed at a cable machine where you would hold an attachment and you push down, and then you lift back up and you push down against resistance. So you're working your triceps to push down, and then the triceps would be working eccentrically to slow the movement down as you lift back up. So note in this picture that the person performing the triceps pushdown they're not starting exactly at 90 degrees and then they straighten and then they only go back to 90 and then they straighten. There's no rule in the strength training world that we start at 90 and go down here and that we don't come up any higher than 90 or start any higher than 90. Like, that's just not a concern, because in general, like I said in the very beginning of this video, we want to be loading and strengthening all of the major joints of our body through all of their ranges of motion, their full range of motion, not just like an arbitrary cutoff of like only to 90 degrees, but no lower. So yeah, with the tricep pushdown, it's that movement is commonly started higher, like, well, hands higher, but acute angle, so a smaller elbow angle, and then we push down. And we actually know from current research that when we strength train muscles in their longer length, which you get a longer length by starting in a more acute angle like this for the triceps, that is research suggests that that's better for stimulating muscle growth. So anyway, tricep pushdown, we don't just start that at 90 degrees and only move within 90 degrees. We actually go through more of a range of motion. And then there's another triceps exercise in the strength training world. This is called a tricep overhead extension. I'm going to show it with the kettlebell, but in this picture here, the person's using a resistance band. But triceps overhead extension, we lower our weight. And if you can watch my elbow angle here, do you see how I come into this very acute elbow angle and then I straighten back up? So I'm loading and strengthening my triceps through a full range of motion. And actually in this overhead position, I have the triceps in a more lengthened position than in that tricep pushdown that I showed. So again, like I mentioned, research suggests that strength training muscles in their longer length, it tends to be better for strength and muscle growth. And overhead extension is actually more of a lengthened position for the triceps than the pushdown. So we get bonus points in the overhead tricep extension. But the main point here is just to look at the elbow angle and to see how it's not the case in the strength training world. We don't learn the tricep extension where we just go to 90 and we look at that and then we lift right back up. It's not a stop at 90 because that's the only safe position. In the strength training world, they understand biomechanics and like joint loading, and we would just never hear a rule like that. Instead, we simply strength train and load the joints through their full range of motion so they can get strong in all of their ranges. So whereas in the insular yoga world, we have this rule on our hands that 90 degrees, this alignment is somehow important for safety. If we take a step back and we look at the broader movement world, we see that not only does allowing the elbow to move through a greater range of motion, not only is that not inherently dangerous, in the bigger picture, it's actually safer because if we load our joints through a greater range of motion, they will be stronger in all of their positions, and therefore they will be more injury resilient. So when we strengthen our joints and make them stronger in all of their ranges, they are less susceptible to being injured. So in the yoga world, by telling everyone that they must stop at 90 and go no lower and only work the top part of the range, we are inherently limiting students in terms of the ability to like strengthen their elbows through a fuller range. So I think that's important to point out. And then just a couple more things to put in perspective for us. I showed some specific triceps exercises, but let's look at the strength training world and a push-up, which is very close, basically the same thing as the yoga world's Chaturanga. There are a couple differences, but in the strength training world, when you learn a push-up, we are not taught in the strength training world to start in plank and then shift forward and only lower down to 90 degrees. Like again, that's just not a rule in the strength world, because in the strength world, we really want to strengthen our joints through a full range. We don't want to provide arbitrary cutoffs where we limit someone's strengthening potential. So in the strength training world, we lower down and you'll see the elbow angle does come into a more acute angle. There's no obsession over 90 just being correct and, you know, going no lower. So, and there's more to say about a strength training push-up. We don't have time to get into that here, but just as far as elbow angle, in the strength training world and the fitness world in general, we load our elbows through a full range of motion all the time in a push-up. And it's great, it makes us stronger. And just one more strength exercise to help us put in perspective, check out a bench press. So in a bench press, we lie on a bench and then we push a weight like this. And it, as you can hopefully see with your movement eyes, that's still horizontal pushing. And so it's a very similar movement pattern in the upper body to Chaturanga and to a push-up. But of course it's different because we're on our back and we're doing that. But in a bench press, it's the exact same thing. The emphasis on the bench press is to move through a full range of motion. So we lower the bar all the way down to our chest, see necessarily the angle of my elbow is acute. And from there, I push the weight back up. There's no rule in the bench press that we only lower to 90 and we like watch the elbows to 90 and then we lift back up. That would be considered like a partial bench press, just partial, where you're just working like a shorter range of motion. But ultimately, for the best, the optimal strength adaptations and muscle growth, we want to work our muscles through their fuller range of motion. And that will involve and necessarily involves taking the elbow into less than 90 degrees. So hopefully that just helps put some, give us some perspective on the matter when we take a step outside of the yoga world. That 90 degree rule is just arbitrary. It's just this aesthetic ideal that our eyes like to see because we like geometrical shapes and right angles. But when it comes to the body and movement and biomechanics, 90 degrees is totally arbitrary. So my hope is that through this video, I've helped encourage all of us to maybe improve our critical thinking skills and how we might apply them to our yoga practice and our yoga alignment rules. And I also hope that this has helped us clarify our movement eyes a bit as far as what's happening in Chaturanga, where the loads are, what's actually working, and how alignment can play a role, but not so much when it comes a role that has to do with injury. Injury is actually more about loads and how much we're loading and the forces we're applying to our joints. And that's a different variable than alignment is. So I hope that this was helpful. Let me know what you think. And if you appreciated this content, subscribe to my channel so you can stay up to date on all of the videos that I share. And also sign up for my email list. Link is in the description because I share all of my content, my free educational content, with my email list on a regular basis.